Mm-hmm. You said you've got a T-Rex?
Uh-huh.
Say again.
We have a T-Rex.
Put your head between your knees.
Dr. Grant. My dear Dr. Thatcher. Welcome to Jurassic Park.
They're moving in herds. They do move in herds. How'd you do this? I'll show you.
Thank you for that.
Hello, and welcome to my review of Horizon Zero Dawn.
This action-adventure open-world RPG originally came out exclusively for the PlayStation 4 on the 28th of February, 2017, but didn't make its way onto PC until the 7th of August, 2020, nearly 3.5 years later. I was glad to see a new intellectual property developed in a market that isn't always the kindest to the risks that come with creating a new game, let alone a brand new IP. The developers, Guerrilla Games, are also the creators of the Killzone franchise. Horizon Zero Dawn had an estimated budget of 45 million euros and runs on their proprietary Decima engine. The company had settled on the name Decima after Hideo Kojima had decided he wanted to use it for his upcoming game, Death Stranding, named after Dejima Island that was once home to a Dutch trading post in Japan. So that's enough background information on the game, let's get into the review. As you step into the world of Horizon Zero Dawn, you'll immediately notice it grabs and seizes your attention from the very start. Visually, the game is mesmerizing and very inviting. The picturesque landscape is resplendent under the noonday sun and shimmers under the luminescent moon. Standing upon a vantage point watching flocculent clouds stream across the sky became a regular thing for me. Traveling from freezing summits to lush valleys, from vast plains into not-so-desolate deserts, all alongside a river that carved out a magnificent canyon will leave you in awe. There aren't many games out there with such an imaginative spin on wildlife, or a giant mechanical giraffe with the Starship Enterprise as its head. The biggest allure into this game is the setting. The world is incredibly original and that made it such a pleasure to explore. As you walk around, you'll see that nature has reclaimed much of the land. You'll encounter machines, a lifeform with technology well beyond the limits of our own, that created such a sharp contrast compared to the Viking-esque lifestyle, hairstyles, and technology of its human inhabitants that you couldn't help but notice and desire to find out how this came to be. While the world is stunning, optimization could use some work. Occasionally during gameplay, there are moments the game would hang on a frame, which caused the game to look like it froze for a split second without crashing. Restarting the game would fix the issue for a little while, but hopefully these small technical issues can be ironed out to provide a smoother experience. However, this wasn't something I would classify as detrimental, as the game was stable and in a good state. Oh, and then there's the thing with Aloy's hair doing whatever it wants. Not much can be done about that. It's part of Aloy's character now. As you explore this world, you'll travel through much of it on foot. Traversal for the most part was fun because of the setting, but interactions with surfaces can be awkward sometimes. Uneven terrain can cause Aloy to get stuck when you least expect it, which may be jarring or frustrating if it happens during battle. Climbing was fast and smooth and virtually baby-proof, but traversing across tightropes was not the most precise with a mouse and keyboard. I found myself occasionally falling off edges when I thought my character would detect it, sometimes leading to my inevitable death. The game employs a fast travel mechanic, but I found myself skipping this feature until the last third of the game, because I didn't want to miss out on the natural scenery or overgrown ruins as I traveled on the dirt road to my destination. Fast travel campfires also served as save points, which will allow you to quick save or create manual saves. Unfortunately, mounted traversal was just okay for me, as I found myself wrestling with the controls, so I didn't find it to be worth the trouble most of the time. However, once in a while, it was fun to ride around. Aside from mounted traversal, overall the controls for overworld traversal were accurate and responsive. The controls during combat were also very good, which helped make combat an enjoyable experience. I played on PC with the mouse and keyboard. As you travel on your journey as Merida, as Aloy, you'll encounter the real headliners of the show, the machines. They are remarkably well designed, drawing inspiration from our wildlife from our present day, as well as extinct prehistoric apex predators. The combat was well developed, smooth, responsive, and most importantly, very fun. It's a mixture of stealth, assassinations, melee attacks, and projectile weaponry, with heavy emphasis on the last one. Each point of damage you inflict on a machine has a chance to tear off components. You'll start out with a spear and a bow, and not far into the game, you'll have access to more bows and other projectile weapons, such as slings, rattlers, tripcasters, and ropecasters. Each weapon will use a unique set of ammo and serve a specific purpose. The game rewards you for being creative and using your entire arsenal of weapons and traps. Using the environment to your advantage can be key and will often grant you the edge over your enemies. As you progress through the story, the machines will become more ferocious, attack faster, hit harder, and be more heavily armored. However, taking each down also becomes increasingly satisfying. As mentioned previously about mounted traversal, this holds doubly true for mounted combat. As cool as it may look, it made encounters harder than it needed to be, and that was a disappointment. I found fighting on my own 2 feet the way to go, and that was good enough for me. Each species of machine had a unique set of abilities and exhibited a pattern of behavior that you'll study and become familiar with. Whether you hunt out of necessity or hunt for sport like a psychopath, you'll learn the vulnerable points and elemental weaknesses that you'll have to exploit. The sounds of coil whine and spooling of gears during combat was fantastic. The visual style, behavior, and sound design of the creatures made them truly unique and memorable. The game provides you with a handful of difficulty settings so you can play a few different ways. Playing on harder difficulties can be a challenge, a misstep or two can mean sudden death, but it made it that much more rewarding when you emerged victorious. Its default difficulty is normal, but you can choose more accessible options with the easy difficulty if you want to feel like a god, or story difficulty where you can play as God's God. You can ramp up difficulty to hard, very hard, or ultra difficult. Very hard and ultra hard will disable aim assist, with ultra hard introducing even more changes beyond damage dealt and damage taken. While I played on very hard, I wish they added an additional difficulty setting between normal and easy, as it seemed like the difference between them was quite drastic, and would provide an additional option for those who may want that. There is no lack of hand-holding in this game when it comes to guidance, so if you want a more immersive challenge, you can turn off things such as quest waypoint markers or certain HUD elements in the menu. The voice acting was solid, it's complemented by decent facial animations for the most part through the use of motion capture. Though there were some cases where characters will look awkward, including Aloy, but it wasn't a big deal. Wow, riveting. Anyways, the story follows Aloy of the Nora, an outcast from birth, raised by her mentor who is also an outcast of the Nora tribe. When you play through the tutorial as a strange-looking child, you'll find an item that allows Aloy to access information via augmented reality, which will allow her to view and interact with the world through a different lens. Curious about her past, her parents, and her world, she sets out to find answers. Along the way, you'll meet new friends, acquaintances, and enemies. I did find there to be an interesting cast of characters, and many were worth helping while on my journey. The story is linear, but it's still decent. However, the storytelling is what carries this game through. Part of what made the storytelling great were the multiple types of conflict. In literature, there are several types of conflict, and this game touches on nearly all of them. and the best part was that all of these are woven together in a believable way. It's told through a series of quests and data points, which can be text or audio records scattered throughout the world that you can unlock with your focus. When you start, you'll have virtually no knowledge of this world, and as you progress further and uncover records from the past, you'll gradually be able to piece together a picture of how this dystopian world came to be. This wasn't a groundbreaking origin story, especially if you're a longtime science fiction fan, but the storytelling was quite good. There were also quite a few side quests to sink your teeth into that can fill out this world a little more. So as you play and slowly uncover the mysteries surrounding Aloy and her world, have some fun throwing out theories along the way. Progression was pretty straightforward. By completing story quests, side quests, and hunting machines, you'll gain experience, level up, and earn skill points to spend. Each quest will have a suggested level, but it never felt like a grind. I spent much of my time exploring and hunting because it was so enjoyable, that by the time I was ready to do the quest, I was many levels beyond what was required. The skill tree is simple and is divided into several different specializations, which will unlock new skills or provide bonuses to pre-existing ones. Spending points into one specialization will not bar you from another. You'll have access to the full tree at all times. Just take notes at these points here, as the skill pathing is subtle. There's a wealth of crafting materials found throughout the world and from the machines you encounter. After encounters, you can harvest components that may have broken off of creatures. You'll use these materials you find to craft ammunition, create consumables, upgrade your bags, or to use as currency in trade. You'll also obtain modifications from machines or as quest rewards that you can use to upgrade your weapons and armor. The customization options in this game are quite light. While this is an RPG, the RPG elements are very basic. You'll be able to purchase most of the gear available in the game, and there aren't that many weapons or armor sets, which is fine given the setting, but I do wish they expanded on this. Each armor set is one piece, so there's no option to mix and match armor pieces. However, there is no in-game cash shop or microtransactions, and I'm happier for it. There are a lot of collectibles scattered throughout the land. While collecting them, it may provide you with information that will not only help you piece together what happened to this world, but it will also bring up just as many questions. Some collectibles that provide lore will come in the form of books, diaries, audio logs, and vantage points that you can unlock with your focus. Other collectibles such as vessels and figures can be used to trade. The music is very good, and the track list is extensive. The soundtrack has a good mix of acoustic strings, winds, percussion, as well as some industrial and experimental sounds blended into tracks. A few notable tracks include Aloy's theme used in the title menu, as well as the song played upon reaching Meridian called City on the Mesa, which are among my favorites. Now I want to talk about my experience playing the game to 100% completion. While not overwhelming, there are a decent number of side quests and errands that will introduce you to new characters. There are just as many side quests as there are main quests, and if you want to complete them all, then finish all side quests before finishing the main quest called the Looming Shadow. The collectibles were fun to gather, and were never really out of the way considering the number of fast travel points on the map. I used the collectibles as a means to explore every corner of the world, which was such a pleasure to be in. If you're not interested or don't have the time to collect everything, but still want more than just the main story, then there are a few things I would recommend completing. One would be to collect each vantage point and read the corresponding letter, as they piece together quite an interesting story. There are also audio data points that are worth scanning. These are found during main missions, and listening to them will give you a better understanding of the world. The third and last thing I would suggest completing is the side quest that requires 3 power cells. The other collectibles and side quests were fun for me, but of course whether or not you choose to do them is entirely up to you. In a market that is somewhat saturated with remasters, re-releases, reboots, and remakes, the creative twist behind Horizon Zero Dawn was something I really enjoyed. To sum up this review, I found this game to be very good overall, and some aspects to be amazing. The game isn't particularly deep, utilizing mostly fundamental RPG or open world elements, but it executes them quite masterfully. The world is spectacular and only marred by some small technical hiccups. Traversal was mostly positive. It did have some small faults, but nothing game-breaking. The combat was satisfying, fun, and engaging. I thought the voice acting was solid and the story was decent. However, the storytelling is arguably one of the stronger points of the game, with plenty of collectibles along the way to help fill in the gaps. Progression and crafting were pretty straightforward and simple, but not bad. Not to mention, the music and sound design were fantastic as well. I think the game could have used an additional difficulty option or two to provide better accessibility, or maybe even adopt the difficulty settings that were used in Shadow of the Tomb Raider for that extra fine tuning. I also would have liked more in-game customization options for Aloy, as it was a little bare. The game wasn't perfect as it could have been optimized a little better, but many patches have come out since its release and it's in a good state now. If you're looking for a vibrant and dynamic, but structured open-world game with unique wildlife and engaging combat, then this game may be worth a try and one I would recommend. Many thanks for watching my review. If you played this game, let me know what you thought, and if you haven't, I'm curious about that as well. Feel free to share your experience down below. Until next time, see ya.